Given Up Food for Funk by the JBs here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. We're broadcasting on over 800 stations, on Pacifica radio stations, low-power FM stations, college and community radio stations. We're also broadcasting on public access TV and PBS TV stations and both TV satellite networks, on Dish Network Channel 9415 Free Speech TV, 9410 Link TV, and on DirecTV Channel 375. And we're video and audio podcasting at democracynow.org. Our headlines are also available in Spanish for any radio station to take, as over 250 are. You can read the transcripts of every broadcast top to bottom, or follow us on Twitter by going to our website and signing up at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman, as we return to journalist and best-selling author of Omnivore's Dilemma, Michael Pollan. His latest book is called Food Rules, an Eater's Manual. Sharif Abdelkaddous and I interviewed Michael Pollan. We asked him about a piece of legislation that Congress is considering whether to reauthorize, the Child Nutrition Act.
The Child Nutrition Act governs WIC payments and the school lunch program.
Women and infant care?
Women and infant care, which is essentially a basket of groceries available to poor women. That is a highly politicized basket. In other words, it's not designed with health in mind. It has far too many dairy products and not enough produce, although it's been modified a little bit. The school lunch program, I think, is one of the most important programs we have and tools we have to basically change American health and change the food system. Right now, that program is, in effect, a dispose-all system for surplus agricultural commodities. For example, during the swine flu epidemic, pork prices plummeted because a lot of people thought you should avoid pork. You could get it. In fact, none of us are calling it swine flu anymore, at the behest of the pork producers, who said, please call it H1N1. And that's why, and the media has gone along with this.
Wait, one thing on that. You were the one who came onto Democracy Now! And said you think you could trace it back to—
Yes, you can, but it doesn't have to do with eating it. It appears that swine flu originated in a big pork plant south of the border in Mexico. The first cases were found in this town. But our pork confinement operations are kind of, you know, petri dishes for disease. And this was all predicted. The Pew Commission on Animal Agriculture, which came out 2 years ago, a brilliant report on the state of animal agriculture with many, many stakeholders involved, predicted, said, the way we're growing pork is a perfect petri dish for new flu viruses and new bacterial diseases. Well, MRSA, community-acquired staph, has been traced to pork production in Canada and the United States and Denmark, and swine flu tentatively has been traced to this particular place. So, anyway, but the reason I was talking about swine flu was that it crashed the pork prices, and the industry went to the government and got a bailout. $300 million, the government bought pork to support prices. And what did the government do with that pork? They pushed it through the school lunch program. So this is what we're doing, you know, with our children.
I want to ask you about one rule here that I find startling. Rule 39, this is in your book, you say, eat all the junk food you want as long as you cook it yourself. What do you mean?
Well, you know, I like French fries. You know, I like all sorts of foods and potato chips, but I also know that you shouldn't eat too much of this kind of food because it has a lot of fat and, you know, many calories and very few nutrients. But one of our problems, I think, with the modern food system and why we've gotten so much heavier is that food that used to be very labor-intensive no longer is. And that the labor cost of food, the work cost involved, has gone down so far because corporations can cook this food very efficiently. So my approach is, if you want to eat this stuff, great. But if you cook it yourself, you're not going to make it that often. I mean, if you've made French fries yourself, which I've done, you know, you've got to wash the potatoes, you've got to cut the potatoes, you've got to fry the potatoes, you're going to make a huge mess in your kitchen, and then you've got to figure out what to do with all the oil. And you're not going to do it that often. You're going to do it like once a month, maybe every 2 or 3 weeks if you really like them. And that's about how often you should eat them. So I think if we kind of take a more personal stake in making those kind of special occasion foods, we'll eat the proper amount.
How about rule number 36? Don't eat breakfast cereals that change the color of your milk.
I got that from a reader. I mean, a lot of these, you know, people submitted to me, and I kind of curated this book as much as wrote it. Well, you know, we've read a lot about the additives in cereals and the colors that are used in the preservatives, and there are real issues about, especially when you combine them with learning disabilities and things like that. So I could have had a rule that, you know, said study this and learn the name of this color and don't, you know, if it's in the ingredients, you know, a kind of complex mnemonic to deal with it. But I thought, let's make it really simple. You know, you're standing in the cereal aisle, you know that those Lucky Charms are going to change the color of the milk because those, you know, they're dyed bits of marshmallow. And that will help you without even having to read the label to avoid that kind of food.
Fruit Loops?
Same problem.
Fruit Loops. Don't they have a special certification on the box for
Fruit Loops? Well, yeah, now they've got, well, actually, that
Not are... that I would know this.
No, well, there was the Smart Choices. You're referring to the Smart Choices label program, which is already defunct. I'm so glad that it didn't last. But basically, the food industry, here's a great example of the nutritional-industrial complex. The food industry and Tufts School of Nutrition, one of the preeminent schools of nutrition in this country, got together to develop a label system to supposedly help consumers distinguish between healthy and unhealthy foods. They came up with this thing called Smart Choices. You would get a check mark on your package if you met certain standards, which were negotiated with the industry. They were not very intense. By adding a single gram of fiber to its cereal, Fruit Loops was able to get this check mark. This is a food that is 40% by weight sugar, okay? This is not a health food by any stretch. Having 3 grams of fiber, and is that really much better than 2 grams of fiber? Is that significant at all? Not really. But in fact, when asked how to justify this, the people at Tufts said, well, it's better for you than donuts. Now, my answer to that is, well, make that the label, better for you than donuts.
Well, where is government regulation on all of this? I mean, shouldn't there be a government-approved kind of check on nutritional value?
You know, they have that in England. They have a kind of a stop-go system, and packaged foods have a red, green, or yellow light on them. And some people think that that's an effective system. I don't know. What it tends to do is make fine distinctions between heavily processed foods. You know, the really healthy food is in the produce aisle. The really healthy food is in the bulk food bins, and there's no label there. So if you want to determine that Fruit Loops are marginally better for you than Lucky Charms, you know, you're playing a fool's game there. It really doesn't matter. But again, we play fool's games all the time with food. We're looking for excuses to eat badly, and the industry is very good at providing them.
47 is eat when you're hungry, not when you're bored. Old wives' tale, if you're not hungry enough to eat an apple, you're not hungry.
Yeah, I find that one really useful.
That's very
when I
interesting.
Think, God, I'm really hungry. Am I really hungry? Would I eat an apple now? Yeah, then I'm not hungry.
You say drink the spinach water, but
yeah.
I have a question about that. What about the pesticides? I mean, that whole issue.
Well, should I have said drink the organic spinach water? Perhaps I should have. I mean, if you're going to
eat it. No, is that a concern, though? The very places in food, like the peel of an apple, where it is most healthy to eat, it gives you roughage, it's got the concentration of the nutrients, is also the concentration of the heavy metals.
Often it is, or the pesticides. I mean, the heavy metals are sometimes internal, depending on what's in the soil, to the food. And, yeah, I mean, any kind of chemical residues you're going to get in food, you're probably going to get in the water. You know, hopefully you've cleaned the food thoroughly, and a lot of pesticides are superficial and can be washed off. The other thing to understand about pesticides is that they don't afflict all foods equally, and, you know, there's a wonderful list called the Dirty Dozen online that lists the ones that have the most pesticide residue. I don't think spinach is one of them. I might be wrong. I would urge you to check it, but, like, broccoli isn't that bad. Strawberries are really bad. Apples are really bad. So it helps you know when it's worth the money to buy organic, to know that, because sometimes it's not, you know, if you're spreading a limited budget over, you know, organic food, there's better places to spend it than others. But a lot of the nutrients are also in that water, and so I advise put it in. Some people drink it. I don't drink it, but I save it for soup stock, and if I'm not going to make a soup or a sauce, I put it on my